Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As we begin our TAPATAN sa Aristocrat today, please observe the following house rules. Please keep your mobile phones and two-way radio sets on silent or vibration mode. There is only one forum at the Aristocrat. Discussions in some other tables are discouraged. And as you are acknowledged to ask our panel, please identify yourself, the entity you come from, and the person you'd like to answer your concerns. You may be entitled to a follow-up. However, keep it short, sweetheart. Okay? Kiss. Cardinal rule is kiss. Magandang araw po sa ating lahat. We will have to do tapatan sa Aristocrat today in English to allow our guests to freely express their thoughts during the discussions. Good morning, everyone. We're happy to have with us newsmakers who will share their views on the hottest issues set before the country and its people, the Bangsa Moro Basic Law. The government and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front are united in their support for the passage of the BBL in its original form. However, there have been changes being introduced while it is being passed at the Ad Hoc Committee on the Bangsa Moro Basic Law of the House of Representatives. So we will begin our discussions this morning. Today we have the distinct honor to have with us in the panel Mr. Mohager Iqbal, Chairman of the MILF Peace Negotiation Panel, Attorney Christian Monsod, Co-Convener of the Friends of Peace, former COMELEC Chairman and member of the Constitutional Commission which drafted the 1987 Constitution. And we have with us Jennevive Cornelio, a representative from the Teduray community. Mrs. Margarita Tingting Kowanko cannot make it. I was just told she's suffering from vertigo. We hope Mr. Abet Ijirani, the spokesman of the Sultanate of Sulu, would be able to make it this morning. It is customary for Tapatan's Aristocrat to allow our resource persons for their opening statements. And so we will begin. What is the Bangsa Moro Basic Law to them? Is it the only road to peace? To begin with, we'll have Mr. Mohager Iqbal. Good morning, sir.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Good morning to all and magandang umaga po sa atin lahat. I have prepared a short opening statement just to guide the participants on where I am coming from. As I repeatedly say, the Bangsa Moro Basic Law is battered from all sides. But it is not yet dead. Those supporting it, including President Aquino, are still hopeful that at the end of the day, it will pass Congress. What needs to be done to pass it safe and sound? This is a difficult question to answer. The truth is that only President Aquino and his allies in Congress have the resource, have the authority and means to secure the passage of the BBL in Congress. All other actors assume supporting roles. In the case of the MILF, it can only play a limited role at the sidelines, especially as a result of the Mama Sapanu incident on January 25. The MILF has since been the object of ridicule and detestation. It seemed the aggressor became the hero and the aggrieved MILF is pictured as the villain. Much of this distortion has been painted black by some members of the media who are identified with the previous administration. By and large, most members of the lower house of Congress, especially those identified with the administration, are supportive of the BBL. But those opposing it, while they are fewer in number, appeared organized and is backed up by a powerful lobby group. In the Senate, except for about four senators, there is almost deafening silence. Frankly, I do not know the real sense in the upper house. maybe some of you here can share us some of your insights. Why is important to pass the BBL? First, the BBL is a menu for unity of this country. More importantly, it is an antidote to secession. What sends people to secede is if they are deprived, oppressed, and persecuted. A contented, happy, and developed population will think twice or thrice before they would embark on a bloody adventure where everybody is a loser. Number two, the BBL has addressed most, if not all, of the legitimate grievances of the Moros against the government. Therefore, any armed group, especially new ones, will have no solid, valid reason or cause to fight the government. They will not succeed because the people will not support them anymore. Three, the passage of the BBL will promote peace and security and progress and development, not only in the Bangsa Moro and Mindanao, but also for the entire country. Those monies used to buy weapons and ammunition will be used to build roads, irrigations, clinics, etc. And number four, once the BBL is passed, the MILF, which is the largest and strongest revolutionary organizations in this country, will rejoin the mainstream society and they will become productive. More importantly, they can be a very reliable and effective partner of government, both in nation building and defending this country. On the other hand, if the BBL is not passed, the MILF will eventually weaken, and those espousing for radical agenda will become stronger because they have proved the MILF wrong in pursuing the path of peace. And number two, it will result in widespread prostration that can generate new anti-government activities, even granting the MILF will stay faithful to what it had stated time and again, that even if the BBL will not pass Congress, it will always pursue the path of peace in the resolution of the Moro problem or question in Mindanao. Besides, local and foreign radical groups will make Mindanao their safe havens. Ladies and gentlemen, come to think of my assertion here. Let us be guided by our reasons and not by our emotions. Remember that who wish for war in Mindanao are those who never tasted the horror and devastation of war. Remember also that we need to settle our internal problems before we can ably confront external threat. Thank you very much, and once again, good morning.
Thank you very much, Chairman Iqbal. Let's hear from a constitutionalist, Attorney Christian Monsod. Good morning.
Good morning. I represent both the Friends of Peace and the Peace Council. I think the basic premise of the position, the basic premise, is that the autonomous region of Muslim Mindanao is a constitutional mandate that to date remains unfulfilled. The passage of the law is needed by the imperative of the correcting the injustices of the past, the urgency of the present, need for peace, and the opportunity that may not come again for us to be so close to peace at this point. Question of autonomy. Autonomy is itself in the Constitution is a peculiarity because the Constitution has a unitary form of government. And except that in the case of the autonomous regions under the Constitution, it creates a local government entity that has more powers and less government intervention than the ordinary local government units. So it is an extraordinary political entity by the wording and design of the Constitution itself. So the Constitution must be interpreted not on a semantics on what words mean. The Constitution must be interpreted to give life to the constitutional mandate of an autonomous region. It is a social justice and human development issue of the Constitution, which is the central theme of the Constitution, social justice and the human development of the peoples. So from our point of view, while the BBL is not a perfect document, if there are instances where the provisions need to be refined or clarified, or maybe a provision must be reworded in order to comply with the Constitution, then that is the job of the legislature. And in our system of in our delicate system of checks and balances and separation of powers, everybody has a role. The executive has been negotiating for 17 years, and in the last 4 or 5 years of the Aquino administration, the executive has been in a peace, has been talking peace, and the peace panels have been working. And the BBL has been the subject of numerous legal reviews by the executive. So that we believe that it should be accorded the presumption of regularity, because it is an official act of the executive of our country. And in that system of checks and balances, the one who is mandated by the Constitution to interpret the Constitution is the judiciary. So that if the legislature, once it has improved the bill, once it has done the refinements and also rewording if necessary, if there are still provisions that do not meet what we call sufficient conformity or sufficient consensus, that must be left to the Supreme Court to decide and not to be deleted by the legislature. Because by deleting it, it deprives the Supreme Court of its proper role in the system of checks and balances and separation of powers. And, you know, the Constitution can declare a provision unconstitutional and delete it, but it cannot legislate. It cannot bring back into the law what the Congress has deleted. And so we are saying that in this system, everybody has a role to play. And none of this, none of the agencies or departments of government should think that it is the center of the world. We must do this as a nation. And we are urging our legislator to look at the legislature, doors, to look at it in that way, that we all have a part in this. This will not succeed. The peace agreement is just the beginning of a long, long journey for our country. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's hear from Jennevive Cornelio, a member of the Teduray community. Good morning.
Isang mapagpalayang umaga po sa ating lahat. Fiogfuan, the simple greetings of the Teduray tribes. Kami po ay galing sa indigenous people structure. Timoy Justice and Governance ay dalawang IPS po or Indigenous People Structure ang nandito ho. Ang Timoy Justice and Governance na sa core area ng proposed Bangsamoro entity at ng Gampa Tekilindaan ni Kamal ng Arumanan ni Menubo na nanggaling sa North Cotabato. Kami po ay hindi anti-peace. Sino pong hindi sumasang-ayon sa usaping pangkapayapaan. Gusto ko lang hong ikukwento yung kung saan ho kami nagsimula sa pag-participate ng usaping pangkapayapaan. Noong 2005, ang Teduray Lambangian at Dulangan Manubo ay pumasa ng position paper at sinuportahan sa pamamagitan ng organization ng Teduray Lambangian Conference o OTLAC, ang full independent state na panawagan ng MILF, at kung mangyari ito ay kailangan magkaroon ng genuine autonomy. Ang IPIS sa bagong independent state, ang resulta ng MUA AD na humantong sa Korte Suprema at dineklarang unconstitution, yun ho yung nagiging participation ng mga katutubo sa loob ng core area, ng mga katutubong Teduray, Lambangian at Dulangan Manubo. Pangalawa ho yung ngayon, yung FAB, CAB at BBL na po sa ngayon. For genuine autonomy of the Bangsamoro po, yun yung pagkakaintindi namin mula sa antas ng negosyasyon at hanggang ngayong nasa legislative branch na ng pamahalaan ay yung assertion ho ng mga katutubo ay full inclusion of IP rights na dito ho hinugot namin sa Republic Act 8371 o Indigenous People's Rights Act na kung saan ay kinikilala ho namin ito na ito yung batas na kumikilala at pumoprotekta sa karapatan ng mga katutubo. Ito ho ay full inclusion of IP rights at no domination of IP rights in existing law. Ang tanging mensahe ho ng IP core or ang tawag ho namin para maiba ho yung identity, in particular ho sa section 2, yung freedom of choice, na inascribe po namin yung aming pagkakilanlan sa amin bilang non-Moro indigenous people. At ito po yung mensahe namin sa core areas, suporta ito demand ng mga katutubo for autonomy ng Bangsa Moro at nang hindi naman maulit yung karanasan ng mga katutubo sa previous autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao. Plain as in simple po, not free rider, not spoiler, not opposition, no evil whisperer, all actual residents of the core area. Kung maisa batas ang BBL na ito, ay batas ng gobyerno for the people and by the people. Happy po tayong lahat. Ang ibig sabihin po yun ay totoong kapayapaan para sa lahat. Walang mapag-iiwanan po. Yun ho ang gusto namin. Gusto ko rin hong mabanggit dito na result nasa Senate na binabanggit nila na walang consultation nagawa sa mga katutubo. Sa amin ho, sa core area na mga katutubong Teduray, Lambangi, Andulangan, Manubo, ay nangyari ho yun. Pero ang tingin ho namin sa ganun ay IEC, Information Education Campaign. Yun yun dating sa amin na ipinipresent sa amin na ito yung pinagkasunduan ng GPS at saka MILF. At ito tayo ngayon. So, binanggit naman ho doon sa freedom of choice of the indigenous people, of the other indigenous people shall be respected. So gusto namin hong linawin yung identity na iba ho, sa ngalan ng IPRA ay iba ho ang pagkakilanlan sa amin bilang mga katutubo at mayroon ho kaming sariling paniniwala in terms of culture. At itong indigenous people's itong indigenous people structure ay hindi ho ito isang ordinaryong organization, kundi ito ho ay nasa loob ng batas ng Republic 8371 na may kikilalanin ng ating pamahalaan yung pagugobyerno ng mga katutubo doon sa kanilang territory.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. We're joined by retired Commodore Rex Robles. To provide us a military perspective of the BBL. May we have your opening statements before we go to the question and answer? What has the AGFO and a retired military officer got to say about the BBL?
Good morning, everybody. I think it's easy for me to give an opening statement because I think June 5, the president of AGFO addressed the Senate, and he gave a very, to me, a well articulated paper regarding the Bangsa Moro law. And there are many points there. All I can say is that so far, in the past debates that have ensued from both sides, I can only sense a feeling that there are definite issues being raised by those who are against the law or against the way the law is being formed. They are not against an arrangement that will solve the problem in Mindanao, but they are against the way it is being solved by the BBL. However, from the side of the BBL defenders, it is all generalities. We hear about we are after peace. We are after the abuse to be recompensed, the recompense of abuse of the Bangsamoro, whatever the word means, which I've never heard of before, only the past few years, Bangsamoro. And it's all generalities. Like, if this is not approved, blood will flow. That's a generality. There's no argument. But there are specific arguments being presented regarding each. And I remember before in the case of the Philippine government explaining the side of the government regarding the Communist Party, we put out a series of articles. I was then in ESAP. We put out a series of articles called So the People May Know. And this So the People May Know addressed most of the issues that were being raised. But we cannot have an argument from the head of the peace panel saying, if there is no solution to this and if this is not approved, there will be a lot of blood. And that is not an argument. That's not an argument.
It's a projection.
It's a pananakot. And we are not after pananakot here. We are after, what are the arguments? Arguments. Three syllables. Arguments. Not saying, if that is not approved, if that is watered down, there will be war. Aba, nakakatakot naman yung gano'n. Okay. Na, pag ano, may labanan pala pag hindi na-approve. Gano'n. Diba?
All right. So let me ask Mr. Iqbal this time. It's being studied and discussed and debated at both houses. And there is this book entitled Power Play that every item introduced at Congress or Parliament will be watered down by lawmakers depending on where they're coming from. Would the MILF accept a watered-down version of what you prepared some months ago? Mr. Iqbal.
The position of the MILF, as far as the BBL is concerned, is very clear and forthright. It was contained in the letter signed by Chairman Murad Ibrahim to the Speaker of the House, to the Senate President, and even to ad hoc Chair Congressman Ropos Rodriguez, that the BBL itself, as crafted by the Bangsamoro Transition Commission, which is composed of representatives coming from the MILF and from the government, 8 from the MILF, including the chairman, and 7 coming from the government, is the position of the MILF. However, realizing that Congress has plenary power over legislation, so in addition to that statement, or in addition to that position that the BBL itself has presented, the MILF welcomes improvement and enhancement. Because, you know, the BBL is not an ordinary legislation. It's not like an ordinary legislation that comes from any congressman or any senator for that matter, but it is a legislation on the basis of a signed document between the government and the MILF that has been ongoing for the last 17 years. 17 years. And the main agenda is really to solve the Bangsamoro problem or Bangsamoro question. That was the agenda of the talks during the first meeting of the government and the MILF negotiators in January 7, 1997. How to solve the Bangsamoro problem. That's the objective of the bill. So if we come out with a bill that is diluted, then it will not solve the problem.
Uh-huh. And this will be unacceptable to the MILF and to your rank and file.
Well, that's the other side of what we said, that the position of the MILF is the BBL itself, but we are open for enhancement and for improvement.
For so improvement, anything, but not dilution.
That's the consequence. If it is diluted, so we are not addressing the problem. Even if the MILF accepts that BBL, then it will not address the problem. So what's the use of accepting legislation that does not solve the problem. Otherwise, we could have accepted the autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao because it had been offered to us 3 times. So if it is the same as the autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao or even lower than that, so where is the sense of the MILF accepting it?
Mm-hmm. Attorney Monsod, how do you look at this? What is basically wrong with ARMM that BBL came into being?
Well, let me just first address the comment of Commander Robles.
Yeah, Commander Rex, yes.
It's not true that people who support Bangsamoro deal only with generalities. If you read the report of the Peace Council, we go into constitutional issues, we go into the issues of the meaning of words, we go into intergovernmental relations, the justice system, the issue of plebiscite. Those are very specific issues that we address. So I'm giving him a copy of the Peace Council report so that he will also see that there are explanations and reasons, and we try to address all those, correct?
Yeah. Now, okay, yes.
Okay, your question.
And the question is, what is basically wrong with ARMM that BBL came into being?
Well, if you go through the literature, first of all, as the MNLF, as the MNLF itself said, the 2 laws that created the ARM were done unilaterally by government. The MNLF was not part of it in the forming of those laws. Number two, aside from that, on the question of the content, one of the problems is the question of fiscal autonomy. If you read through it, it seems like there is fiscal autonomy. But in the way it's being implemented, or the way at least people see it as how it should be implemented, there was no real autonomy. In fact, that's one of the problems on the comments of the Committee on Appropriations with respect to the ad hoc committee. It seems to be saying that it should conform to all the regular functions of budgeting. Whereas the idea of self-determination, if we really want self-determination, we have to make some distinction between civil and political rights, which are cast in stone, right? The Bill of Rights, suffrage, citizenship, and all that, those are cast in stone. But when we talk about social and economic rights, those are proper subjects for devolution of powers, because that's where the self-determination comes in, is whether they have the power to frame their own development. That's why if you read the Constitution, the broad powers that are supposed to be given to the Bangsamoro Parliament are huge, right? Ancestral domain, economic, social, and tourism development. You know, in law, when you take a look, for example, what does economic development mean? What are the powers of economic development? Then you begin to unbundle it, right? Unbundle it. Like, for example, in the Constitution, we talk about public utilities, where the law, the EPIRA, unbundled that public utilities and said, well, there are 4 sections there, right? There is the generation, transmission, distribution, and supply. And only 2 of those are real public utilities. So when you start unbundling the rights that are being devolved by the Constitution, you will come out with a list of 58 powers. And they say, well, no, that's too much. Well, then you have to review it. If you take a look at those powers, most of all of them are unbundling of the 9 powers being given by the Constitution itself to Bangsamoro. Now, how can provisions of the Constitution be unconstitutional? How can that be? If they're in the Constitution, how can we say they're unconstitutional? Like the provision on ancestral domain and natural resources, right? Mm-hmm. But that is there. That is a power given to Bangsamoro. So we have to be very careful in balancing the rights of indigenous peoples and balancing the powers that are supposed to be devolved to Bangsamoro.
Okay. Well said. Jennevive, sa tingin nyo ba kasama kayo doon sa mabibiyayaan sa BBL? O nararamdaman nyo ba na etsapwera kayo?
And sa usapin pong yan, minsan ay nakausap namin yung panel ng GPS na ano ba yung status ng mga katutubo, lalong-lalo na sa core area, sa loob ng ARMM, Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. Ang parating sinasabi ho, sinasagot sa amin ay hindi naman kayo kasali sa pag-uusap. Ang GPS at saka MILF lang ang nag-uusap.
Bakit?
Humantong po doon sa usapan na yung humahawak lang ng baril ang nag-uusap, hindi yung...
Katulad nyo?
Yes.
Wala kayong baril?
Wala po.
Sigurado yan?
Yes.
Pangahawakan ko yan?
Opo.
Talaga. Bakit kayo naitsapwera?
Dahil hindi ho daw kami kasama sa usapin.
Hindi kayo kasama dahil wala kayong armas?
Yes. Hindi kami nag-aarmas. Ang kinakausap lang nila dito, yung nag-aarmas. So, you, wala ho kami doon.
Would you care to react?
I don't know. You know, I'm looking at the report of the OPAP to the Senate. And there's a list of 32 meetings and consultations with the IPs. Now, the IPs are saying that these were just informing them of the peace agreement. Well, that was signed in 2000. When was that signed? And even before that comprehensive agreement, there were already as far back as 2011. And so my question is, are any of the sentiments of the IPs expressed in those meetings or in written submissions to the OPAP, did they find their way into the, at least let's talk about the ad hoc report, no? Because even the Peace Council's recommendations, for example, very specific recommendation on increasing the number of reserve seats for indigenous peoples, and she was there when in the Peace Council plenary that we had. That's in the ad hoc. That's in the ad hoc committee report of the House, increasing the reserve seats of IPs in the Bangsamoro Parliament. And there were certain rights that we suggested be affirmed, and I think most of them were also included in the ad hoc. But having said that, we must also interpret the constitutional provision that the Bangsamoro Parliament has power to pass laws on ancestral domain. If we say that that the existing laws are all cast in stone and every provision therein, that means that power is not there. So as I said, there is a very delicate balancing here of interest that must be done. And I believe that the Bangsamoro Parliament is well aware and sensitive to these issues. And mm-hmm. we must give it a chance. Because as we said, the peace agreement, even the law, is not the end of the peace process. And in the statement of the framers of the Constitution on January 11th, 2015, before Mama Sapano, we said that the Bangsamoro government must also exercise its powers with the same magnanimity that the central government gives to Bangsamoro, and also with the same kind of statesmanship we expect from our legislators.
Okay. Inasmuch as we're pressed for time, we will open the floor to our friends from the media. We will acknowledge you. Please introduce yourself. And please tell us whom you'd like among the panel members to answer the question. Okay? We'd like to acknowledge our friends from FOCAP who are with us this morning. Let's begin. Please.
Anybody from you guys?
So far? From New York Times? Later. All right. Please.
Good morning, Tess Ramiro from Catholic Media Network. This is addressed to Mr. Iqbal. Chairman, paki-disabuse nga po ang mind namin. Kasi kung ordinary, nilagay ko po ang sarili ko sa posisyon ng ordinaryong mamamayan na gustong unawain kung ano yung BBL.
Ang punto po, paki-English mo dahil...
Yeah, because, okay, sorry. One of the things that we really wanted to find out as an ordinary citizen, for example, would be why is there a Bangsam Moro basic law? Why is this being offered to the Senate for review? Why is this being debated upon right now by people who are against and who are pro? And what is your stand with respect to people who really refuse to understand your position and the positions also of the indigenous peoples? Thank you.
Thank you, Tess. Mr. Iqbal.
Very difficult question.
The question is, why is there a need for the BBL?
No, why is there a BBL?
Oh, why is there a BBL?
You know, it's a long story. Let's make it very brief. Huh? The Moro people, once upon a time, were not part of this republic. And even Manila and Tondo belong to our people. When the Spaniards came, there was a war between Spain and the Moros. For more than 300 years, the war went on undecided. So when the Spaniards left as a result of their defeat from the United States of America, Mindanao and Sulu remained a foreign territory. When the Americans came, they were so different from the Spaniards because the Spaniards were only interested to Christianize the Muslims or the Moros and to get our lands. But the Americans were not interested in Christianizing the Moros. They are only interested in the economic and the political aspect. So they recognize that the Moros of Mindanao were different and were not part of the Republic of the Philippines. And that was the reason why they created the Moro province. And the Moro province comprised 5 districts. Sulu, undivided Sulu, undivided Chambuanga, undivided Cotabato, undivided Lano, and undivided Davao. These are the Moro province. This is the Moro province. And the Moro province is more than 90% Moros and IPs. But right now, we are only about 30%. So, about 30% or even less than 30% of the original Moro province. So, when the Grant of Independence, the Moros were against the Grant of Independence by having their part of, by having Mindanao and Sulu as part of the future government of the Republic of the Philippines. Well, they were against that. They even sent petitions after petitions, and the most important document of this petition was 1924, wherein it was signed by practically all the major leaders of the Moro people. And in that petition to the Congress of the United States, they said that we are against the Grant of Independence by including our part of this archipelago. But if the United States of America wanted to pursue the Grant of Independence, they just let our part of this archipelago belong to us. So that 50 years after, there would be a plebiscite. And the Moro people, they said, Moro Nation. They said that the Moro Nation would be given the opportunity to choose whether to become part of the Philippines or to remain a separate colony of the United States of America. So that was the first time the word Moro Nation was used. Originally, when you refer to Moro, it means you are a Muslim. It has never been a political term. But during that petition in 1924, for the first time, the word Moro Nation was used. And then the corresponding interpretation of Moro Nation is Bangsa Moro or Moro Nation. Moro Nation. In short, when in 1935, there was the Dansalan Declaration signed by more than 100 leaders of Lanao saying that we do not want to be included in the Grant of Independence. We do not, because if we will be part of the Philippines, they will get our lands. They will try to do something that would disadvantage our people. So what happened later was that even during the, when the Moros were already part of the Philippines, true to what our forefathers had said, that we will not be treated as equals. We will always remain a second-class citizen. So they were not happy until such time that in 1968, this is an eye-opener, the Chavina massacre. Then the Moros, we were students here in Manila already. We realized that even under the so-called Republic of the Philippines, the Moros are not safe. We're not safe. We were in Corregidor, very near here, in Cavite. About 64 Moros were massacred by government troops. And then later on, the Ilaga was organized, and tens of thousands of our people died. And then when martial law was declared, in Palimbang, more than 1,000 people died. In Pata Island, more than 2,000. In Patikol, more than 700. So on and so forth. So in other words, even that our people were already part of this republic, we are not treated equally and as equal citizens. So we organized the Moro National Liberation Front. We organized the Moro Islamic Liberation Front and tried. First, our objective was to have independence. To have independence. But later on, with the intervention of the Organization of Islamic Conference, it was mellowed down to autonomy, real autonomy. Real autonomy. And that is what is in the proposed Bangsa Moro basically right now, to address a particular problem. Mm-hmm. And that was decided by government and the MILF, as I said earlier, in 1997, that the only agenda is how to solve the Bangsa Moro problem. So this would require really a solution, because we are distinct from the rest of the Philippines. We have separate narrative, we have separate different custom and tradition, we have different custom, we have different religion. So I think it is about time that we look at where we differ.
Okay.
Not where we are in common. In common, no problem. But where we differ is the problems. We have to address this. This is a political issue. And that is the reason why the BBL should be passed by Congress to address a very long history of conflict in Mindanao. Because if we do not pass the BBL, then the problem will proceed. I'm not saying that we will declare war. True to the in deference to what my good friend here said, we never said that we will return to war if the BBL does not pass Congress. We have been very consistent in our statement that no matter what happens to the BBL, rest assured, we are assuring the nation that the MILF will stay engaged in the pursuit of peace in Mindanao.
Yeah, thank you very much. But you know, Mr. Iqbal, had the Americans not intervened in 1898, then we would have a better country, right? But you know, with friends like the Americans, they always, you know, who needs enemies?
That's why in a brief encounter with a British, I said how we wished that the British would have colonized us instead of the Americans. Because the British are not very concerned about the political side. They are more concerned about the economic side. You see, Malaysia, they were given independence. But in the case of the Philippines.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Just to follow up on the point of the BBL, sir. Is it possible then, given the circumstances right now as presented in Congress, are you hopeful or do you feel almost frustrated? Your actual feeling, sir, about the whole situation as they stand right now. Thank you.
You know, madam,
Tess.
We get inspiration from Ferdinand Magellan. Okay. Ferdinand Magellan, the one who introduced Christianity in the Philippines. For about 3 months, they were in the high seas, seeing no island. The only order was sail. And then at the end of about 4 months, they were able to sight an island in Visayas. Meaning, when we started to launch our struggle in 1972, we never imagined that we'd reach this point.
Yes.
And when we started to talk with the Philippine government in 1997, we never imagined that we'd reach this point.
Yes.
Because we know that everything does not come in silver platter.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So it's part of our struggle. But to tell you, madam, I'm still hopeful that BBL would pass.
Given the circumstances also, are you in speaking terms with the MILF? Thank you. Are you? Are you in talking terms or dialogue with the MNLF regarding your situation?
We have an open line. We Thank can talk you. To anyone in the MNLF
I guess
at any time.
The better question would have been, do you utilize the open line?
Yeah.
You can have the open line, but if you don't use it, then...
And for the information of Madam,
yes.
Last May 27 and 28, there was an Organization of Islamic conference in Kuwait, wherein Murad was invited, and he addressed for the first time, coming from BMILF, for the first time that he addressed the conference of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. And practically all the factions in the MLF, because the MLF has five or six factions.
Yes.
And they were represented in that conference in Kuwait. We are in talking terms. We only differ in some aspects, but generally we agree on most of the issues.
Thank you very much.
Okay, next question.
Good morning.
Please identify yourself.
I'm Makon Araneta from The Standard. This question is addressed to Mr. Iqbal. Actually, sir, I have two questions. So the first question, would you consider the BBL version passed by the House Ad Hoc Committee as a watered-down version? And the second is, what's your take on the substitute bill that Senator Bongbong Marcos is planning to pass in the House? In Senate, sorry. Thank you.
And that's the reason why we didn't invite Senator Marcos here. Okay? Because he has a pending bill, Ms. Iqbal.
Like in an examination, you will know the average when all the grades are coming in. So we look at the average, meaning if all the inputs in the Senate and in the House are put together into one bill, then that's the time that we'll make our own rating. But for the moment, personally I would appreciate what happened in the Ad Hoc Committee. I've been repeatedly saying that quantity-wise, 90% good. Quality-wise, 50% good. But that would, I still hope that in the plenary that would improve. But there is still another level of engagement that could further improve the BBL. It's in the bicameral conference. So we are looking at it as a process. Yes, a process. We are not looking it at a certain level of engagement, not just in the ad hoc. We are looking at in its totality. So that at the end of the day, when everything has been accumulated, then that's the time that we will say that this is acceptable, this is not acceptable. At this point in time, it's premature for me to say anything about that. On the Senate, of course, Senator Bongbong Marcos, I do recognize him as a leader. I respect his view. But personally, I think what I can say here, in line with that advertisement in the television, kung saan ka masaya, yun na lang gawin mo.
Oh, thank you very much. No, this is a good one. Questions from our colleagues from the media? Yes, please.
Hi, sir. Good morning. I'm Maricel Halili from TV5. To Chairman Iqbal and Attorney Monsod, may we have your reaction regarding the proposal of former Chief Justice Renato Puno for a constitutional convention so as to ensure that the provisions in BBL won't have any conflict with the present constitution?
Sir. Alam mo, at this point in time, pari-pariho tayo. Pari-pariho tayo. Senator, congressman, abogado, hindi abogado, maybe we can have our own personal view. But at the end of the day, it will always be the Supreme Court that decides whether this is constitutional or not. But this point in time, I think I would look at the 18 surviving members of the Constitution as the most authoritative people because they were there. They know the letter and the spirit, the intention of the law. So in terms of giving some authoritative percentage, I would go for the 18 surviving members. Not that the good lawyer here is here with us this morning, but that's my sense. They were the ones who crafted and drafted the 1987 Constitution. They know the intention. They know that a particular word is the one that is suited to the to that intention. So I would go for them as more authoritative than any other people. We do, with all respect to all of them. That's my view here.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Good morning. I'm Juvie De Guzman of DWBL. My question is addressed to Chairman Iqbal.
You're the flavor of the day, Mr. Chairman.
Bangsamoro Basic Law is one of the famous talking points of the country now. How can you prove that this is the only road to peace? Would you mind to explain to us for us to convince that BBL should be passed?
I am fully 100% convinced that is under current circumstances, this is the best way to peace. Because, as I said, we have been in the negotiation for the last 17 years. And it has passed all levels of engagement, from the technical committee level of the panel, to the level of the peace panel, to the Bangsamoro Transition Commission, where there were more than 10 lawyers, from the engagement between the BTC and MILF and the Office of the President, led by Chief Executive Pakito Ochoa Jr., and Chief Legal Counsel Kagiwa and three other lawyers. On our part, we have a battery of lawyers. We have discussed that. And then it had gone to the level of the highest, from the President to the Chairman Murad, have discussed seven issues. So it has passed all levels of engagement, and we are very, very sure, to our level-based knowledge, that it is constitutional. Of course, there are other people who say that this is unconstitutional. And more importantly, with the participation of the 18 surviving members of the Philippine Constitution, I think that added to the clout of the BBL as something very constitutional, except one issue, the issue of opting provision. That's very contentious, very contentious. Mm-hmm. So that's my belief. Otherwise, 17 years of negotiation and all these levels of engagement, and then we are not still convinced that this is the best way forward, I think, that's why what we
is that
think.
The question?
Yeah. Okay. Never in a moment that I doubted that this is the best way forward to establish in Mindanao.
Okay, thanks so much.
Would you care to add to that, Atty. Monsod? You were once a member of the Constitutional Commission. Your views about it.
I don't know if many of you read the statement of the framers of the Constitution, as I said, issued January 9. 2015. But you might want to read it because in answer to the question on whether a peace agreement is the answer, we quote from the Human Development Report of the country of 2005. And we say, rather than hardship alone, the sense of deprivation, injustice, and indignity lie at the heart of armed conflict. Often not even the most abject conditions for themselves cause grievances, much less revolutions. The revolutionary argument is that deprivation and indignity can be relieved, injustice remedied, and national cohesion achieved only by pursuing resolutely some promised alternative. People must perceive and be conceived that something higher and better than their present condition is possible. That is why there is a peace agreement. It's because that's the way out of the armed conflict. And we are, the constitutional commissioners, were already presented with this problem, what's the alternative and all that. But the reality is that there must be a better future that we can promise the people of Muslim Mindanao so that there can be peace there. And we also say, autonomy is an we took this from somebody who testified. He said, autonomy is an expression of the Bangsamoro conviction of its being a viable alternative to separation. The Bangsamoro is historically and culturally a distinct and separate nation. and the political fusion with the Christian majority is workable only under the framework of political autonomy, which shall allow the full flowering of the genius of Bangsamoro in the context of the Islamic culture. That's in the constitutional records, if you want to see why we approve the autonomous region under the constitution. All right, let me just say, we said that the full flowering of the genius of a people is human development. That's what human development is about. That's the mandate that we must follow and pursue in pursuing this peace. Now, let me also say, on behalf of the non-Moro indigenous peoples, if you read the case of the IPRA on how it was affirmed by a 7-7 vote, which is a tie, and that's why it remains in the books. A senator told me, "Do you know what's going on?" I said, "What?" He said, 4.5 million hectares are being allocated for the indigenous peoples. And she said, "What will we do about that? Many of those lands are now in other hands." And I said, "Well, there are solutions to that, either reparation or return, or even all kinds of solutions in other countries." But I said, "Did it occur to you that when this nation started, the indigenous peoples, non-Moro and Moro, owned all of this land, and that they lost it because of neglect, because of oppression, and because of unjust laws?" Right? Somebody said that poverty is not a disease that has no solution. It is brought about by our laws, corporation law, property law, labor law, and everything. That's what the result of that is, poverty. It's not that there are no solutions. It's just that we don't want to. That's why we haven't solved that problem of social justice and human development in our country. Let me refer to the paper of Senator Miriam on Bangsamoro. If you read it, she makes two assumptions that I think shows her mindset. She says, ordinarily, and I'm quoting from her report, "Ordinarily, peace is discussed between the sovereign and the opposite camp only after the former has militarily imposed its will on criminals. Peace negotiations are not substitutes for military success." In other words, she is saying that you must pursue a military solution even before a peace process starts. Her second assumption, she says, quote, "What relationships persist between the MILF and the MILF is not easy to determine." And she asserts this, quote, "What is sufficiently clear is that both seek to detach themselves from the government of the Republic of the Philippines." That's not a correct assertion. We know that. If the Muslim peoples have been negotiating for 14 years and gone through all of these reviews, legal reviews, why do they need the law in order to secede? They can secede anytime if they want to. But they have elected not to secede and to pursue peace. We must recognize that they are giving up their dream of independence to be a part of a united country. Why can't we recognize that?
Okay.
And then the report of Senator Miriam, however, ends by hedging her reservations. She says that in the case of Bangsamoro, it can be done, essentially, she's saying that, by the principle of subsidiarity, where you devolve power as close to the people as possible. Well, the principle of subsidiarity is Section 6 of Article 4 of the BBL. She may have missed that. Anyway, what I'm saying is that is the position of the Committee on Constitutionality. And if you read to it, it ends, in effect, on a good note that it is possible, despite all the rhetoric about it's not possible. Mm-hmm. And that's the same thing with the report of Senator Marcos. He begins by saying there were no consultations of any kind to the people that he heard in Mindanao. Where maybe he did not read the OPAP report that says there are 553 consultations since 2011. And then he goes to a rehash of the arguments that mm-hmm. also went to the House. Things like, well, you cannot give constitutional powers to regional groups on audit, on civil service, on COMELEC, and so on. He forgot to read Republic Act 1954, which gave these powers already to ARM. And so withholding it from BBL is a step backward and can be construed as bad faith on the part of the government.
Yeah.
So I think we should look at it from a perspective of history. You know, as Mr. Iqbal says, we must look at it from a point of view of history. This is not an ordinary law that only starts in Congress.
Mm-hmm.
This is the product and of a process that's been going on for years. And we have somehow to have a good solution to this problem.
Yeah, thank you. How I wish I would be able to read the statement of Senator Lito Lapid about the BBL. But I guess that will not be forthcoming. Please.
I'm Floyd.
Please identify yourself, sir.
I'm Floyd with the New York Times. Could I ask all the members of the panel their thoughts on the prospects, of the agreement? If the BBL doesn't pass during the Aquino administration, is there a plan B, or is there, what are the prospects for peace and for the law after Aquino?
Okay.
I'll sit down so I can take
it. All right. So let's begin. If it does not pass, what will happen? This morning, on my way to TAPATAN's Aristocrat, I met Archbishop Oscar V. Cruz, and he said he's worried because if it passes, those who have been left out may cause trouble. If it does not pass, then the MILF may cause trouble. So anyway, there's a question of the gentleman, what will happen if it indeed does not get passed during the Aquino administration? Yes, let's start from the military man.
Well, I'm already retired, so my outlook is a little bit more more moderate.
Moderate.
Because when I was in the military, when some breakaway groups or some what we call groups are declare war, then the military man, I would say, so be it. So be it. Pero ngayon, hindi na tayo so be it. Pag-isipan natin. Kasi people talk over a table, mayroong negotiating table. I don't think it will really be a problem to go back to the negotiating table if something very serious happens to a point where the whole proposal is rejected. So I feel that it's a question of paabaan na lang ng pasyensya kung kaya ng both sides to go into another round and look closely at the defects. Because for instance, as I sit here, the arguments that have been presented by everybody here who are in the panel, everybody else, I find no serious disagreement. Ang sa akin lang, if I go back to the military position, the devil is in the details, but the details that we are trying to clarify are not the details that are being presented. For instance, regarding the point of Chairman Iqbal here and Professor Monsod, I find myself agreeing all the time. So, walang problema. Ang sa amin lang is yung period of yung sequence of disarming or decommissioning and so forth. Those are the details mm-hmm. that we are most worried about. If that is taken care of, then, and there are examples worldwide about it, then to me, I find no problem with giving constitutional powers to an autonomous government. As a matter of fact, I would favor, and I will make I'd take a risk here, autonomy for any group that has been treated by the government that long and that badly. And for instance, we are complaining about the South China Sea as being claimed by the Chinese. I think we should give it to the Chinese because they deserve it. We don't deserve saying that we own the South China Sea when we have not done really anything much to show that it is ours. So, ganun din sa Mindanao, kung wala namang ginawa ang gobyerno para alagaan ng Mindanao, but natin gustong ayaw nating ibigay sa mga MILF, ibigay natin sa kanila. Baka mas magaling pa sila.
Yun ang maganda. Mula sa Teduray.
Sa history po, ay yung pinanghahawakan namin yung history na mamalu na ancestors ng mga katutubong Teduray at ganun din yung paniwala ng Arumanen Manubo. At yung mamalu at si Tabunaway naman ay yung ancestor ng mga brothers naming Moro. So, malinaw ho dun sa sacred peace agreement ng mga ancestors na mayroon silang klarong hatian sa territory at mamumuno ng malaya doon yung magkapatid before nag-embrace ng Islam si Tabunaway. So ang si Mamalu ay nanatili siya doon sa pagiging indigenous people niya na may sariling paniniwala.
Okay.
And then may sariling pamumuno at mayroong teritoryo. So yun yung basehan ng aming mga position ngayon na ang usaping ito ay right to self-determination, na kung ibibigay ang right to self-determination ng isa, paano naman yung isa na hindi makikilala yung right to self-determination?
Okay. Opo. All right. Yes. So yun ang issue natin.
Yes.
Mahalaga yun.
Opo.
Yes, Professor Monsod.
Well, it would be a pity if the Bangsa Moro basic bill is not passed because we are so close to it. For the first time, both leaders on both sides trust each other, and that's so important in the peace process. To now allow it to lapse into another administration on issues that are easily solvable from our point of view, the framers of the Constitution, the constitutional issues being raised are eminently solvable by rewording, by refinements, and so on. And there is a lot of grandstanding going on. There is a lot of milking the surveys, where the surveys show that the nation, 40% of the people are not in favor. They ignore the fact that when we talk about self-determination, you should take a look at the results of the surveys in the areas where there's supposed to be autonomy. And what is that? That's as high as 90% net and as low as still net, 18 or 20%. In other words, it will be an overwhelming vote for the BBL in a plebiscite. Now, let me address the suggestion of Chief Justice Puno. Chief Justice Puno, as well as Senator Miriam, is saying, we need to change the Constitution to accommodate the BBL. Well, first of all, as I said, we think it can be done without a constitutional amendment. Secondly, I think Chief Justice Puno forgets that this constitution that allows and in fact mandates the autonomous region of Muslim Mindanao as a special case of local government and mandates Congress to enact an quote-unquote organic law, right? Mandates Congress to do that, was approved in a national plebiscite of a great majority of our people, I think 84% in that national plebiscite. So why are we asking for another plebiscite to give them the autonomy that's already authorized by our constitution? So I don't understand that. I think part of the reason is that there are other agendas. If you take a look at the, what you call the joint resolution number one of Congress now, to amend the economic provisions of the constitution, which I don't know why it includes education, by a wholesale transfer of power from the constitution to Congress, by merely adding the phrase unless otherwise provided by law to 9 or 10 provisions of the Constitution, correct? There is a move going on to, in effect, water down the Constitution. Why? There is no need to amend the Constitution to pass the BBL. This has been gone through so many legal reviews. And there is no need to change the Constitution to so-called invite investments. And there is a big debate about that, and this is not the place for it. But first of all, I agree, we must respect the Constitution. But let us read it correctly. For example, the word Bangsamoro, they say, oh, that's unconstitutional. There is nothing in international law that defines the word Bangsamoro, which means that we can define it the way we want to. We can say it's the homeland of Filipino citizens in Mindanao, right? Of non-Moros and Moro indigenous peoples who are part of the country, who are part of the territorial integrity and sovereignty of the country. We can define it that way. And once it is approved in a plebiscite and accepted by the community of nations, that will enter the lexicon of international law with our definition. Nobody tells us how to define it. That's an opportunity for us. And that goes for many of the so-called constitutional issues on the meaning of words.
Thank you very much. Chairman Iqbal, please.
In answer to the question about
what will happen if it doesn't pass?
If the BBL is not passed. I just want to reiterate or restate what I have said a while ago regarding the possibility of the BBL not passing Congress. As I said very clearly and forthright, that no matter what happens to the BBL, whether it is passed or not passed, especially when it is not passed, the MILF will stay engaged in the pursuit of peace, in the resolution of the problem in Mindanao. I have to restate that time and again because we do not want to be misquoted we are trying to say that if the BBL is not passed, then we will go to war. Yes?
The engagement is for peace.
Yeah, for peace, yeah.
Because you can also engage in war.
Yeah. Okay. And then secondly, I think I have to say also here, in accordance to an old adage, which says that opportunity knocks only once. Meaning if we cannot have the BBL passed by Congress right now, I don't know what year, what administration would present itself that this kind of opportunity will come again. I don't think that will come again. Maybe the next generation of leaders of the Moros would be the one, because we are already in our last stage of our life. And we have been in the struggle for more than 42 years. I studied here in Manila. I went home in 1972, direct to the jungle, joined the MNLF, and later on in 1977, joined the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, which was then known as the Moro, the new MNLF leadership. So I'm still here. Maybe if this will not be passed in Congress, then next generation of Moro leaders will come in. And maybe new negotiators will spearhead any other group in Mindanao that will talk to government about solution to the problem in Mindanao. Anyway, I just continue my answer to the question by reading again what in my opening statement. I said, if the BBL is not passed, on the other hand, if BBL is not passed, first, the MILF will eventually weaken and those espousing for radical agenda will become stronger because they have proved that the MILF wrong in pursuing the path of peace. And second, if the BBL is not passed, it will also result in widespread prostration among our people that can generate new anti-government activities. Even granting, the MILF will stay faithful to what it had stated time and again, that even if the BBL will not pass Congress, it will always pursue the path of peace in the resolution of the Moro problem or question in Mindanao. Besides, local and foreign radical groups will make Mindanao their safe havens. And finally, remember also that we need to settle our internal problems before we can ever confront external threats. That's my answer to the question.
Okay. Thank you very much. Would you care to have a follow-up? No follow-up? Yes. You're referring to the characters presenting themselves to be presidential timbers.
For the MILF, we don't engage in election. But we are establishing a political party, United Bangsa Moro Justice Party. Maybe they will be the one that will determine who will be their candidate comes 2016.
Not at the moment. None at the moment.
For the MILF, not in every moment. We do not join.
Okay. Thank you for being clear. Yes, please.
Good morning to everyone. I'm Jerry Kibilan. I'm glad to hear what Chairman Iqbal said. He's very categorical in what he said about the fact that if the BBL will not pass by June 11, there will be another opportunity and they will not go to war. The question raised by Rex Robles is very alarming, which we have read in the papers many times. Yesterday, Congressman Lito Atienza, I asked him directly about what he feels about his confidence in the BBL being passed, because he's one of the most vocal person in Congress against the BBL. And he told me that he's very ambivalent. So going to the Bangsa Moro nation, it appears that some legal minds think that is a federal system of government. I'd like to ask Chairman Monsod about his legal opinion to clear the air.
Yes, please.
The autonomous region of Muslim Mindanao and the Cordilleras are exceptions, what we call asymmetrical relationship, which many people misunderstand. Asymmetrical simply means that the relationship between Bangsa Moro and the central government is different from the usual relationship between local governments and the central government. That's all it means. Now, having said that, the autonomous region is not federalism. It is not federalism. It's a peculiarity in our constitution. It may be close to federalism, but it is not federalism as we know it. Because, for example, the residual powers are not in the states, as in the United States. The residual powers is in central government. So that's just one example of why it is not federalism. But having said that, the remaining members of the Constitutional Commission got together and we're saying, actually, Bangsa Moro is a very good experiment on whether we are ready for federalism. Because when we were writing the Constitution, we realized that what was important at the time was to unite the country, which called for a unitary form of government. But if we can make a success of Bangsa Moro, we can revisit the question of federalism in our constitution. And that the way to do it is to make a success of Bangsa Moro, because that is already allowed by the constitution.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We'd like to acknowledge we also have with us former Congressman Dante Liban in the audience. Thank you for dropping by. You may have a question later, okay? Yes.
Pat Santos po, for Chairman Iqbal. Chairman Iqbal, you were once, there was a suspicion that you are an agent of Malaysian government. Suspicion. Huh? I'm saying, once the BBL passed and the MILF governs Moro, will you pursue or will you help Philippines to regain or reclaim the Sabah Peninsula?
Referring to Sabah?
I did not get well your question. The first question: are you saying is your question about me as an agent of Malaysia?
There was a suspicion. Suspicion. From, you know, it was printed in all several. Will you clarify?
Sir? I am part of the Philippines. I am a citizen of the Philippines. Although my identity is Bangsa Moro, I'll remain to die here, inshallah, not in the Philippines, not in any other country. Yeah.
Once the BBL passed and you govern the Mindanao, will you help the Philippines too?
Well, that has been a very persistent question asked of us many times. Why is Sabah not part of the agenda of the GPH and MILF peace negotiation? You know, starting in 1975, when the Tripoli Agreement started to take off in the discussion, Sabah was never part of the agenda. In 1986, was never part of agenda, meaning Sabah was never part of the agenda of the government and the MILF when they signed the Jeddah Accord in 1986. 1996, there was no mention about Sabah. And in the case of the government and MILF peace negotiation, Sabah is not part of the agenda because Sabah is a foreign affairs issue. We have nothing to do with that. So how could we discuss something which is not part of the agenda?
Will you support?
Huh?
Will you support once the BBL passed?
Well, it's a historical fact that there is such claim. But whether how to proceed, how to approach that issue, whether sovereignty approach or proprietary approach, that depends on the government of the Philippines and the Sultanate of Sulu. Sultanate of Sulu. I have nothing to say about that because that's a historical claim. And even Malaysia recognized that historical claim. Although it has there was intervening situation wherein there was that referendum in Sabah in 1962, wherein the Sabahans voted in favor of their association with Malaysia.
And there was no PICOS at that time. No?
Can I just add that in relation to what happens afterwards if the BBL is not passed, I think there is a consequence to that we have not mentioned here. The consequence of that is we will not look very good in the eyes of the international community. Because the international community is very much in our peace process. If you look through the different committees, for example, monitoring team, on decommissioning, on transitional justice, they are headed by foreigners and not Malaysians. Everybody is attacking the Malaysians. I think that's not fair. In the observation team, for example, there are 5 countries, Malaysia, Japan, Brunei, Indonesia, and Norway, right? In the decommissioning, the chairman of the committee is the ambassador from Turkey. We have other committees headed by a Canadian, headed by the former European ambassador to the Philippines. The whole world is watching us, how we do, how we accomplish this peace process. And they have been with us a long way. So let us not forget that if we, out of partisan politics or grandstanding, do not do well by this peace agreement, we will not look good in the international scene.
Okay. Mr. Iqbal, Mr. Chairman, I came across a manifesto about the BBL, which says, number one, Malaysia. The choice of Malaysia's third-party mediator was ludicrous because it is conflicted. Malaysia opposes our Sabah claim and has persistently undermined our nation's stability as a state that funded, organized, and trained secessionist groups, originally the MNLF and subsequently the MILF. Would you care to react to this?
I will not provide a very long answer to that, but I just focus on why Malaysia is part of the peace process. In 2001, as her first state visit outside of the Philippines, President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo went to Kuala Lumpur and talked to the Malaysian government to provide third-party facilitation on the government and MILF peace negotiation. Because before that, there was a total collapse of the peace process. There was a total collapse of the ceasefire. So in order to bring back the parties to the negotiating table, then there has to be some sort of an improvement in the mechanism. Because before that, from 1997 up to the middle of 2000, we were facing across the negotiating table military generals. For instance, Major General Fortunato Abad, Major General Edgardo Batenga, Major General Orlando Soriano, those are military generals across the negotiating table. Those stages of the negotiation we called domestic stage. But after the collapse, because of that all-out war against the MILF by President Joseph Estrada, everything collapsed. So in order to revive that, after Estrada exited from office, President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo went to Kuala Lumpur, talked to Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad the possibility of providing third-party facilitation. So when it was presented to the Malaysian government, the Malaysian government did was not to accept it outrightly, but they sent representative, they sent emissaries to the MILF about the possibility of Malaysia having to act as the third party facilitation. So in other words, Malaysia was invited. Malaysia has no way to enter the negotiation except by invitation. So Malaysia was invited.
Okay, thank you very much. How does the MILF view the political clans in Mindanao, the political dynasties? I need not mention the family names. But while some of them say, we support the BBL, I believe deep in their hearts that will be their death. So how do you look at them?
You know, modesty aside, if there are political clans in Mindanao, there are political dynasties in Luzon and Visayas. And if you look at most of those who are running government, with due respect, they belong to the Maharlika during the Spanish time. And they are still here. So if we have clans in Mindanao, you have dynasties here in Manila. But in answer to your question, I think, you know, it's like a man suffering from illness. The moment we find the right medicine, then everything eventually will fall into place and the patient will become well. Of course, that would require the intervention of leaders. Even if the laws are good or the best laws we have, but if those running the laws are not good, then nothing can be expected of it. One social scientist, I think it was during the time of the Greeks, that he said that the best form of government is a benevolent dictatorship. Although I do not believe in that, because if you are a dictator, you can never be benevolent because you are a dictator.
Mm-hmm. Okay, more questions from our media friends? Oh, yes. Yes, please.
Yeah, Leo Santiago po, maritime journalist. This is what I'm bothered. It has been explained that the BBL is a special law created through the process of people consultation, etc. Blah, blah, blah. And then, as a sovereign issue, it should be solved by somewhat sovereign measurement of what the Filipino people like or not, does not like. So I suggest, I don't have much respect to present Congress, so I suggest that we conduct a referendum whether this is approved by the people or what. What okay. Can you say?
Well, that's the issue of plebiscite, sir. I think I mentioned that earlier, that the creation of the autonomous region, as well as the mandate to Congress to enact an organic law, was approved already by a national referendum in 1987 of over 40% of the people. Are you saying now that we don't recognize that? Why do you need a referendum now? Another referendum to authorize the BBL?
This is new government.
I beg your pardon?
This is new government and new people.
It's not a new government. What we're saying, autonomous region. Now, if you say that the autonomous region is a violation of our sovereignty, please show me the provision in the BBL that offends our sovereignty. Because you know the definition of sovereignty is it has certain attributes. What are these attributes of sovereignty? It was a population, land, governance, and ability and capacity to engage in formal relations with other countries. Bangsamoro doesn't have the capacity or the power to have formal relations with foreign countries. So it lacks at least one of the attributes of a sovereign nation. So how can that be a diminution of the sovereignty of the Philippines? Now, as far as powers being given to Bangsamoro, that is in the Constitution itself. As I said earlier, how can a constitutional provision be unconstitutional? So I don't understand the argument that we must first have a referendum of the entire country in order to be able to enact a Bangsamoro law. Senator Miriam says, well, organic doesn't mean organic means constitution, And organic means, basic means constitution, it means organic, and those are not allowed because we cannot have two constitutions in a country. But the constitution itself says to enact a, quote, organic law. Is that unconstitutional? You see my point? But we are arguing about the meaning of words when the answer is in the constitution itself.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Aside from the timetable, you know, it's been said that if it will not be passed during the Aquino administration, there may be some conflict. Do you see such possibility that conflict may come in should the agreement or the BBL not get passed during the Aquino administration?
Well, certainly there will be conflict because a lot of people expect and are waiting for their liberation, their self-determination. But I trust the MILF when they say that they will not do this through armed conflict. But you cannot stop the fact that there are other factions there. And part of this is answer to the question of Commodore Rex. What about decommissioning? There are people who say they must first lay down their arms before we can talk peace. That's an impossible condition. Because if you do that, then the MILF will not be able to address all the questions and that are being raised today about local factions and Abu Sayyaf and BIFF and all that, right? You cannot. If you disarm them, they're sitting ducks to those spoilers of the peace process in Mindanao. For example, in many countries where peace has been successful, it takes years for decommissioning. In the Belfast Agreement, for example, of 1998, it took 8 years for to finally lay down all the arms. And there were 3 extensions of the decommissioning. But that's how a peace process goes. You have to balance it, that the ability of the new government to survive as against, you know, trusting them that there will be more armed conflict. The fact is, there are many factions. There is an underground economy. There's a shadow economy there, with people with a lot of money who are spoilers. And we have to allow the Bangsamoro people to deal with those problems directly by giving them a certain amount of armed capability. And that's why they can have a police force, although that is subject to the NAPOLCOM, as you know. And all of these people who say that that will now be an armed force for secession are just wrong. They are wrong. If you read the provisions of the Constitution and in the BBL. Incidentally, that provision in the BBL was worked upon by a special commission, including foreign experts on peace. That one that you read in the BBL, they helped craft that provision. And that took into consideration what's happening in other countries.
Okay. Very well. We have questions from our colleagues from FOCAP, Gurley, Dana, Attorney Dana, and Iggy. No questions so far? All right. Okay. Yes, please.
It's about the indigenous people, so.
Please.
Historically speaking, the Tidorais and the Maguindanaons have only one common ancestor, Mamalu and Tabunawa, who are brothers. And in relation to the MILF, one of the founders of the MILF is Sheikh Abu Khalil Yahya, who is 100% Atiduray. And in the current negotiation, do we have members coming from the IPs? For instance, Dato Antonio Kinok, a member of the MILF panel, who is dead already last month. And right now, with us is Commissioner Milanyo Ulama, who is also Atiduray, and replaced Dato Tony Kinok in the MILF panel. If you look at the provision of the BBL, yes, aside from that, in the Bangsamoro Transition Commission, there are 2 members of the Bangsamoro Transition Commission who are pure 100% Tiduray, in the person of Commissioner Milanyo Ulama, who is here, and then Commissioner Froilan Mendoza. In the case of the Maguindanao, which is the largest tribes among the Moros, we only have one. I am that. The second member of the BTC, who is a Maguindanan, resigned in the person of Attorney Juhaira Wahab. So the biggest has only one representation in my person. But the Teduray has two representation. If you look at the provision of BBL about indigenous peoples, these are entirely taken from the agreement between the group of Commissioner Milanio Ulama and Commissioner Froilan Mendoza, facilitated by the Notre Dame University, led by Attorney Benny Bacani. So what they have agreed and they signed that, we incorporated that without any deletion, without any amendments. It is in the BBL itself. So nothing has been added, nothing has been deleted to the provision of the BBL about the indigenous people's provision in the BBL. So what I'm saying here is that the right to self-determination, which cannot be qualified whether external or internal, because even in the IPRA, it did not qualify whether RSD can be external or internal. It merely says RSD, right to self-determination. So what I'm saying here is all the provisions of the BBL on the indigenous peoples are a result of the exercise of right to self-determination of the Teduray themselves.
Okay. Yes, please.
Magandang nabanggit po ni Chairman Iqbal yung representation po ng mga IP sa GPS panel at saka MILF. Si Froilan Mendoza po ay inappoint ng GPS panel at si Timway Melanio Ulama ay appointed ng MILF panel po. So, may mga consultation na ginawa during the Bangsamoro Transition Commission na ang naalala ko ay kinandak ni Commissioner Froilan Mendoza sa mga municipality ng Maguindanao. At ginosulta po ang mga katutubo kung ano yung tingin sa draft BBL. At may nabuo kami doon, I think 145 provision at humantong pa kami sa isang mga provision articles na gusto naming maisama doon sa bubuuin basic law. Pinag-usapan yun sa level nila at hanggang sa na-reduce po yun ng 65 na provision ang natira hanggang sa umabot sa 13 ka-provision ang natitira. Noong ipinasa sa Office of the President ay ibinalik muli sa Bangsamoro Transition Commission yung draft na bill, yung BBL. At doon ho ay kung hindi ako nakakalimot noong August 2014 ay urgent po nag-meeting yung BTC, yung MILF panel at saka yung GPS na ihingiin yung mga nakalagay doon yung IPRA at saka yung ancestral domain. Dahil hindi ko ho alam, hindi ko ma-express ngayon kung bakit hindi nila matanggap yung Indigenous Peoples Right Act at saka yung ancestral domain. Na klaro naman doon nga sa nabanggit ko kanina na mayroon kaming hatian doon sa teritoryo at mamumuno doon yung non-Moro Indigenous people at saka yung mga IP na nag-embrace ng Islam ay hindi ho yun questionable sa amin dahil free sila. Yun yung pag-ask. Yes, yun yung ibig sabihin ng freedom of choice sa amin. Na kung choice nilang magpa-convert ng Islam, nasa kanila yun. Itong usaping ito, very critical ho sa amin dahil ang pinag-uusapan dito ay ancestral domain, pag-gobyerno at saka yung identity. Ang sa tingin namin yung as Bangsamoro people ay parang hindi malinaw sa amin yun.
Matutunaw kayo.
Yes, mawawala kami. So, ang pinag-uusapan dito yung ancestral domain ng mga katutubo. Na ngayon, pinag-uusapan nga ngayon, ako nanggaling sa community, habang pinag-uusapan yung kapayapaan ay yun yung exploration ng mga pagmimina sa aming mga katutubong lupain.
Okay. Sige. Let's hear from Attorney Monsod. Paano natin ma-reconcile yung karapatan ng mga katutubo at ng mga kapatid nating Muslim sa BBL?
Let me say that yung pong ad hoc version, there is already a lot of reconciliation there. I think you'll agree that a lot of things have been put there. On the question of identity, I was just talking to Chairman Iqbal. There is the term non-Moro indigenous peoples appears in the ad hoc version that came out of the House. So it is recognized. There is identity. So just maybe you want to say it again somewhere else. No? So now, as far as the rights of the indigenous peoples are concerned, they are protected by the Constitution. And there is a basic principle in constitutional law that the Constitution is deemed read into every law and every contract in the country. Even if it is not mentioned in any law, it is deemed read into every law and every contract of the country. So as far as the indigenous people's rights are concerned, their rights are in the Constitution itself. That cannot be violated by any law. So that's how we should interpret. Now, in international law, on what they call lex pacificatoria, or the law of peacemaking, there is a principle of interpretation that said that sometimes you have to engage in what they call constructive ambiguity in order to have peace. What does that mean? What does that mean? Let me translate it this way. For example, when they talk about Belfast and so on, when there seemed to be a conflict, what they said was, you assert both rights because you cannot possibly anticipate the result of any case that can be brought up. If you want to provide for specific cases, you will have a very, very long basic law because provided that, provided further that, and so on, trying to anticipate every possible case. So what you do is put down the principles and let the Supreme Court interpret whether in that case the Constitution has been offended. So that is what it means. It doesn't mean obfuscation. It means simply that there are certain cases that cannot all be anticipated in a law, and you cannot put them all in the law, otherwise be too long. And that's it. And the other principle is there is such the term as constitutionalism in process. In fact, in other countries, it is mandatory that they change the constitution. Nepal, for example, they had to change the constitution to get the communist insurgents into the picture. South Africa, they could not agree. What did they do? Because beforehand, the blacks and the whites could not agree on a constitution. So they said, why don't we enact a temporary constitution? And once the new Congress comes into the picture, then they can write a permanent constitution. And that's how they achieve peace. This is what I mean by peacemaking. As long as we say that the peace is a primacy over everything in the country, there are ways to go about it to make it possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Yes, please. Please identify yourself. Please.
Yeah, speaking is Timoay Milanyo Ulama, a pure-blooded Teduray, living in the core territory of the Bangsa Moro. The chairman of the umbrella organization of the Teduray, Lambangyan, and Dulangan Manubo in Central Mindanao. And at the same time, recommended by the IPs in Central Mindanao as their representative in the Bangsa Moro Transition Commission. Speaking of the rights of the indigenous people in the BBL, but before that, I would like to ask that lady IP speaking in behalf of the IPs, are you also living in the core territory of the Bangsa Moro?
Yes, sir.
First time as chairman of the umbrella of organization of the three tribes in Central Mindanao. Ngayon lang kita nakita. But then, I would like to ask, that I would like to say that we in the Bangsamoro Transition Commission had more than 1 year consultation, not only the in the core area of the Bangsamoro territory, but also outside the core territory. And I was surprised that we IPs are different position paper now when we submitted our when we submitted the BBL in the Congress. And we are also surprised that there is an inclusion of the IPRA law in which nothing in the BBL. And you know, this is the story of the IPRA law. IPRA law was created October 29, 1997, as Indigenous People's Rights Act of 1997 during the time of President Fidel Ramos. Right after the creation of the IPRA, I, as chairman of the organization of the Teduray Lambangian Conference, the umbrella organization of the three tribes, immediately we petition for the devolution of the IPRA law in the arm. But sad to say, brother and sisters, hanggang sa nawala ang petition namin sa central office ng NCIP, Kapipornes ang upap, nawala lahat and nothing happened. Ang kwan ko lang dito is, sana kami sa Otlak is yung mga tao doon is we remain in the previous provision of the BBL that we submitted. Hindi na po namin babaguhin yun. Ayaw namin ang IPRA. With your respect, ang IPRA halos sa ngayon. Ako, ganito na ang katanda ko, pero I'm still IDPs. Hindi pa kami nakabalik sa aming lupang ninuno. And yun sana, brother and sisters, na masaya kami pagkaroon ng IPRA law in 1997. Ngayon, nakaroon ng Bangsamoro. Sabi ng mga IPs, ito na ang panahon.
Okay.
Ito na ang panahon. So kaya, sa mga kababayan ko ng mga IPs, as your representative, as your commissioner, gusto ko sana na wag tayong magpagamit sa mga tao sa likod natin. Dahil ang gobyerno mismo, yung ating mahal na presidente, ang Central Committee ng MILF ay supportive sa atin. Hindi tayo tinuturuan ng MILF. Ang sa atin, nandyan ako, nandyan si Commissioner Mendoza para gagawin namin ang provision sa mga IPs. And brother, can I suggest one of my companions in Thailand?
We were pressed for time, I'm so sorry. But we have taken note of what you said. Sa sinabi ninyo, I just have one question for you. Pwede bang itaga sa bato ang sinabi mo?
Yes. Pwede pa itaga sa lahat ng bato.
We can hold on to it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Ang mga kapatid namin na Moro ay hindi kami ginagamit. And for additional, ang forefathers namin, brother, is magkapatid.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Short reaction.
Thank you, sir. Hindi mo nga ako nakikilala dahil ng isang ordinaryong nanggaling sa community. At ikaw ay kilalang kilala ko dahil naninirahan ho ako sa South Upi, in particular sa Barangay Luoy, South Upi, Maguindanao po. Matagal na ho ako nandyan at kumikilos para sa mga karapatan ng mga kababaihan. At ito yung dahilan kaya sobrang assert namin dito sa Indigenous People's Rights Act. Dahil simula nang naisabatas ito noong 1997, sabi mo nga, ay within 18 years, hindi na-implement ito sa autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao. Na ang pagkaalam namin sa batas na ito ay national law. So, ang ibig sabihin sa isang ordinaryong tao na umiintindi sa mga batas na ang batas ay walang pinipili na rehiyon. Kung isang national law siya, ay talagang mai-implement ito para sa lahat. Yes. Kaya consistent naman po kami sa aming ina-assert ngayon na i-implement ang IPRA sa loob ng ARMM dahil hindi namin ito natikman within 18 years.
Okay. Sige. Thank you very much. We're not here for a debate. We have next question, last question from Elmer Bandol of Legazpi City. Elmer, I promise the good chairman will be here until 11 o'clock.
Thank you.
But we cannot serve lunch.
Morning to Mr. Christian Monsod, because you are part of the framers of our constitution. Do you think it is high time to overhaul our constitution?
Overhaul of the constitution?
I heard about, you mentioned that there are some possibilities unexpected that should have been written in our constitution.
No, I mentioned it in the context of if we are successful in Bangsamoro, maybe that's the time when we should revisit the issue of federalism versus a unitary form of government. I am not advocating for an overhaul of the constitution, but I think we should have a national debate on this. They will have a national conversation on this. Because the fact is, we have not fulfilled the social justice and human development mandate of the Constitution up to today. We are the basket case of Asia on poverty. We have the lowest growth rate in 50 years. We have the highest or second highest inequality in our part of the world. We should do something about that. What I'm afraid of when you overhaul the Constitution is that then vested interest comes in, and they water down the social justice provisions of the Constitution. That's what I don't like. And that's what is beginning to happen when they're saying they want to water down the nationalistic provisions of the Constitution, even today. So in a constitutional convention, you know what the agenda is of the vested interests in this country. I think Chairman Iqbal said, of course, there are political dynasties everywhere. Mm-hmm. The fact is, our society, up to today, is a very feudalistic society. And if you water down the social justice and human development provisions of the Constitution, which is the theme of our Constitution, we will go nowhere.
Sa complicated issues ngayon na nararanasan natin regarding BBL, kailangan na ba na magkaroon tayo ng bagong qualifications sa ating mga leaders, like the President?
Mahirap po yun eh. I think
how to read and write only.
We can only have minimum conditions. But with respect to the coming elections, there are two things I think we should look for in a candidate. Number one, he must not be corrupt or corruptible or have any taint of corruption. Number two, they must know what social reform is all about. Because up to today, our leaders, since we had the new constitution, are cut from the same cloth. They come from the ruling elite, from the feudalistic part of our society. And something is very wrong with that. What we need is a new generation of leaders from below. The poor must be represented everywhere for us to have a new social order.
Yeah. Thank you very much. We're pressed for time. We'd like to get the closing statements of our panelists. What do they see in the near future, 2016 and beyond? At tinanggihan na rin yung tanong kung ano tingin sa cartoon characters running for the presidency. Let's start with the lady. Anong nakikita mong kinabukasan natin as a country and as a people? Jennevive.
Siguro para sa akin, nanggaling sa community, ay nung kasagsagan ng usapin ng BBL na ito, ay isang katahimikan na rin siguro ng mga tao sa community dahil pansamantalang natigil yung giyera, ika nga. At hindi na rin kami nagbabakwit dahil kadalasan naman na ang biktima ng giyera ay yung mga katutubol dahil sa loob ng ancestral domain. At siguro, sa tingin ko, masabatas ito na yung balance yung pagtingin nung tunay na kapayapaan na walang mapag-iiwanan, lahat nakasmile, kung sa tingin ko, yes, lahat humahalakhak dahil ito yung tunay na kapayapaan.
Ayan, naalala ko yung isang kaklase ko noong elementary. Laging nakangiti kahit umiiyak. Medyo oversupply yung ngipin niya. But anyway, Rex, how do you look at the near future?
Nag-retire ako 1999. Nagtrabaho ako privately up to 2 years ago. And most of the time, I was in Mindanao. I was in South Cotabato, Sarangani, almost lahat na mga minahan na puntahan ko. At ang napansin ko, kung ano ang mga lugar na nakakaiyak dahil sa ang mga gumagawa, let's say, nagpa-plan sila ng mga mais, mga ganon, hindi nila madala sa town para ibenta kasi yung daanan, it's impossible. Kung minsan pati kabayo, ayaw dumaan eh. Yung pag inano mo siya sa putikan, gaganon yung kabayo. Uh-huh. It's really impossible. And we don't have the political will to improve these portions in, ako sa Mindanao lang.
Mm-hmm.
Habang nangyayari yung mga ganon, habang those things happen, these problems that are being raised by the MILF and even other groups will persist because it is they see it every day. They see it every day. So palagay ko, in the long run, even if we have this BBL, if the government continues to be self-centered, as pointed out by Professor Monsod, that na feudalistic tayo, we will still have problems. But I am sitting here as a member of a panel, but actually I feel like I'm a member of the audience kasi ang sarap makinig. Ang sarap makinig.
Uh-huh.
At panay ang ganun ko sa'yo kasi galing doon. Diba, ang galing ka ako. So I'm happy that I'm here. And if only the government will help in putting out the side of the pro-BBL, like in the way we did it in the 80s, 70s and 80s, when we put out a series called So the People May Know in the hundreds of thousands, para lang mabasa ng mga tao. Hindi ko nakikita ang gobyerno na tumutulong. For instance, tinitingnan ko yung mga hawak ni Chairman Iqbal. Saan magaling ito? Mga ganun. But hindi ka dito natulungan na mag-spread nito. Even the book that you gave me, sir, it's the first time I saw it. But it's so good. It's full of goodies. So sana ganon na information, this information age, information is the tool, is the weapon. Mm-hmm. If it is used properly, then we will have a better future.
Thank you. Yes, please.
You know, when Pope Francis came here, we were one nation. And in the convocation in the University of Santo Tomas, a 12-year-old girl from the slums of Manila asked him, why did God let this happen to us? And what did the Pope say? The Pope said, there are some questions that can only be answered with silence. But he said, when you face your challenges, maybe you can look at things in a new way, with eyes that have been cleansed by tears. Didn't he say that? Our country is awash with tears. It's about time we looked after our people and the full development, human development of all the peoples, particularly those most neglected, which are the indigenous peoples, Moro and non-Moro. They are the most neglected in our country. Let us think about this and maybe we can look at things with eyes that have been awash with tears.
Thank you very much. Chairman Iqbal, please.
For how many decades we have been guided by mainly, not everybody, by our emotions. And much of our approaches are on the basis of fear, on the basis of mistrust, and perhaps bordering to what we called hatred. So saan tayo dinala noon? Eh, hanggang ngayon eh, up to this time, there is still conflict in Mindanao. Conflict is still there in Mindanao. And that's why we have a ceasefire agreement. And that is why we started to talk peace with the government of the Philippines. And that is the reason why we have gone so far in crafting the Bangsamoro Basic Law, because we want to address a conflict. And after after addressing this conflict, and we come forward to the normalization process, then everything would become normal. But it is a process by itself. It's not something that we can just cut corners. It's something that we have to follow the process. It's about building blocks. It's about incremental process. And we need really that we have patience. We have patience. Mm-hmm. Because if we do not have that patience, if we do not persevere, then we will not reach the point where we can have peace in Mindanao and elsewhere in the Philippines. So my view here is that the problem in Mindanao is not just a legal issue. It's more than a legal issue. If you try to address the problem in Mindanao, what we call the Moro question, or more problem, through strictly legal approach, then we cannot address the issue in Mindanao. It's a political issue that would require mainly a political approach. That's why, in the case of the Constitution, I think there is a need really to be very flexible in the minds of people, especially lawyers. It's not in the flexibility of the law that we want to avail of, but it's in the flexibility of people who try to interpret the law, because the Constitution, as far as we are concerned, is too shallow and too limited to address a historic problem that had accumulated over centuries. So that what I'm saying here, in short, is that we need to look at the problem as a political problem, mm-hmm. and not a pure and simple legal problem. And by that kind of approach, maybe we can be very flexible, can be very creative in approaching and solving the problem. And this is my appeal. And for the creation of what we call autonomy in Mindanao, it has historical antecedent. During the American time, colonizers, after knowing that there are two distinct groups of people in the Philippines, they created two special provinces. They call it the Moro Province and the Mountain Province. So we have all the antecedents in history that we can look at it very seriously, mm-hmm. and try to improve it so that we would be able to cultivate our differences into something, unity in diversity. In Malaysia, they cultivate that racial harmony. In Indonesia, they try to cultivate that harmonious relationship between all the groups in Indonesia. Even in Singapore, they are trying to pursue a policy wherein all the racial groups in Singapore are banded together into one distinct nation. So what I'm saying here is that in the Philippines, we will try to look at our diversities, not just where we are united. For those where we are commonly united, there is no problem about that, because we know already, there is that commonality already. But we shall try to look at where we differ, so that we would be able, at the end of the day, to have a sort of a rainbow. A rainbow is made up of 7 colors. Roy G.B., I memorized it even in high school. Red, orange, yellow, green, indigo, and violet. Roy G.B. So if we can have a rainbow in the Philippines, it's so beautiful. I think this is the aspiration, not just of the Moros, the indigenous people, but the entire people of the Philippines, that we should have a very, very beautiful rainbow in the Philippines, wherein the basis of our relationship would be trust, uh-huh. accommodation, and fraternal relationship. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. With that, we bring to a close our special edition of Tapatan's Aristocrat. We thank you for being with us, our distinguished members of the panel.
Mm-hmm.